Good morning, California Creek Baptist Church. This is Pastor Josh, and I want to welcome everybody to Easter Sunday. And he has risen from the dead. We are here to worship together for the next little bit, and it's good to have singers with us today. And Mr. Brian is going to come here in just a second and start us off with a song, and then Kenny and Dana is going to come and sing for us here in just a couple minutes as well. Before we get started, though, let's all join together in prayer, and then Brian is going to come and sing. So let's pray. God, we thank you so much for this day. It's a day of victory. We are here today together through technology to worship a risen Savior. I'm so thankful that the Holy Spirit is with us. The many folks that are tuning in at home, they can worship there due to the fact that you did arise from the dead, and the Holy Spirit has come as our comforter and our guide and is the one ministering to our heart today. So I pray that during the next few minutes that Jesus Christ will be glorified. He will be honored in everything that we do. I'm so thankful again for this day and what it represents. And I'm thankful as children of Christ, the resurrection is with us every day of the year. And so we again celebrate you arising. Holy Spirit, again, be with us these next few minutes together. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you. Do not cry for me. All of this is exactly how it's supposed to be.
I'm right here. Can you hear my voice? My love, my own baby boy.
And as they led me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will to have your son and my son?
Whatever happens, whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become me. This is not the end. I have made all things new again.
I remember you were born in that manger where I first held you in my arms. So many miracles, lives you've changed, and this world repays you high all this pain.
And as they nailed me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will to have your son and my son?
Whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become of me. This is not the end. I have made all things new again. Whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you have become, this is not the end. I have made all things new again.
Thankful that that was not the end. If you're tuning in with us, please take your Bible now and turn to Luke chapter 24. Let's read about his resurrection together. For a few minutes this morning, what we're going to be talking about is under the title, Nonsense. Luke chapter 24, We're going to read 11 verses. We're going to start in Luke 24, verse 1, and read the resurrection story given to us from Luke's account. Luke chapter 24, in verse number 1. I want to encourage you at home, you have been doing this for several weeks now, grab you a pen, a pencil, a piece of paper to take some notes on. There's several things we're going to discuss this morning here concerning his resurrection. And Luke chapter 24, verse number 1, the Bible says, "Now upon the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they came unto the sepulchre, bringing the spices which they had prepared, and certain others with them. And they found the stone rolled away from the sepulchre. And they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. And it came to pass, as they were much perplexed thereabout, behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. And as they were afraid and bowed down their faces to the earth, they said unto them, Why seek ye the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spake unto you when he was yet in Galilee, saying, The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, and be crucified, and the third day rise again. And they remembered his words, and returned from the sepulchre, and told all these things unto the 11, and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene." I want everybody to remember this lady's and her name. We're going to talk more about her in a few minutes. But it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary, the mother of James, and other women that were with them, which told these things unto the apostles. And their words seemed to them as, underline this at home, as idle tales. And they believed them not. Let's pray. Jesus, help us the next few minutes as we examine your resurrection. I pray you would open up our hearts and minds to receive the message you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. A few years ago, an article was released highlighting 11 invictions that changed the world forever. They were, and I list, fire, the wheel, electricity, the cotton gin, paper and pen, the steam engine, automobiles, airplanes, the telephone, the World Wide Web, and Facebook. Those were the 11 inventions that were highlighted in the article that changed the world forever. What I want us to do this morning for just a few minutes is talk about an event and a person that changed the world forever. That by one event, his resurrection and his life, the world has never been the same. 11 ordinary men in the book of Acts, we are told, go on to turn the world upside down in his name. An entire book was written about him, and that book is the Bible. When you read the resurrection account, the Bible student needs to do justice to the scripture by reading all four Gospels. When you read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you begin to piece the events together in its totality of what happened on that marvelous morning. What we know by reading Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John is that there were three women mentioned by name that found the empty tomb. The three women that were mentioned by name were Mary Magdalene, Mary, the mother of James, and Salome. And then also we read that there were other women that are not mentioned, but are mentioned by other women,
that were with them that came to the tomb to lay spices there. When we begin to think about the resurrection account in Luke chapter 24, these verses that we have read, we need to ask the question, what did they find on that morning? Well, in verse number 2, take your pen or pencil if you have one, mark this with me, they found that the stone was rolled away. If you notice in 24 verse 2, and they found the stone rolled away from the sepulcher. I want to just briefly say this morning that the stone did not roll away so Jesus could get out. The stone rolled away so that they could see he was not there. In verse number 3, they found something else. They found that the body of Jesus was gone. In verse 3, mark this, they entered in and found not the body of the Lord Jesus. Now, this is significant. It's significant in the fact that he is not any longer in that grave. It's significant in the fact that it raises the question, where has he gone? I want to say this. This is not the message this morning, but we understand that while he was in that grave, the book of Revelation tells us that he snatched the keys to death and hell. That is our victory while he lay in that tomb. And so when we think about the stone rolling away, we think about the body of Jesus was gone, we need to talk about what were they told. We see in verse number 6 that there was an angel there that gives them word. Look what it says. This is important. Here is your victory. He is not here, but is risen. If you're at home today, you ought to shout hallelujah right there. You ought to praise the good Lord that Jesus is no longer in that tomb, but Jesus is risen. So what they were told is he's not here, but is risen. So they have great news to share. I want to ask everybody a question this morning. Do you believe? Do you believe Jesus rose from the dead? See, his resurrection is what sets him apart from others in the past who have claimed divine status. In Jingchuan County, Pingliang, China, there you will find the cremated remains of Buddha. At the Green Dome, Medina, Saudi Arabia, you will find the tomb of Muhammad, the founder of Islam. Within the walls of Old Jerusalem in Israel, you will find the ornate shrine known as the Edicule, inside the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. It is believed to be built around the tomb of Christ. I want to say that if you travel there to Jerusalem and you go into the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, that tomb is empty. Just in the last few years, what we also have discovered is outside of the old walls of Jerusalem is another area that is suspected to possibly have been the tomb of Jesus. Let me say this. I have been there and seen the Church of the Holy Sepulchre. I've been to the second site that some claim could have been the tomb where Jesus was laid. Let me say this. Both of those tombs are empty today. He is not there, for he is risen. I'll never forget that moment when we went to both of those sites. You could sense and feel the power of the Holy Spirit all around, because let me say, Jesus is alive. What we do know about the tomb of Jesus, according to the scriptures, was that it was new. It was unused. It was made by Joseph of Arimathea, and it was a tomb that was borrowed. It was a tomb that was only used for 3 days, and we know that he arose. I know it's asking a lot. When we asked you a question a few minutes ago, do you believe? I know it's asking a lot to put your trust in someone you have never seen with your own eyes. To put your trust for eternity in someone you never met is to ask a lot. See, think about it for just a second. It would be insane to buy a car you have never test driven or laid eyes on. Imagine buying a house you never saw a picture of. Crazy? I mean, it sounds crazy to me. Well, right after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, what we see in all four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, is that some doubted, and even the apostles doubted, and thought it was nonsense. Listen to the scripture. Let the scripture talk. Matthew 28, in verse number 17, write this verse down. You can go back later and mark it, but it says, and when they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. In Mark chapter 16, in verse number 11, it says, and they, when they heard that he was alive and had been seen of her, believed not. And then in Luke chapter 24, the passage we just read, in verse 10, the last part, in verse number 11, look at it, let's read it again. Mary Magdalene and the other ladies told these things unto the apostles, and look at verse 11. And their words seemed to them as idle tales, and they believed them not. Those two words, idle tales, are actually one that mean nonsense. I mean, think about that just for a second. These men who had followed Jesus, had been with him throughout his earthly ministry, now that he has went and accomplished what he said he would, they believe what they're hearing is nonsense. When we look into the scriptures, we also see one of the disciples, and this is kind of infamous passage in John chapter 20, 24 and 25. But Thomas, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples therefore said unto him, we have seen the Lord. But he said unto them, except I shall see his hands, the print of the nails, and put my finger in the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side. Listen to these words. I will not believe. See, this morning, let's talk about the faith to believe. I do not believe it to be a coincidence that Mary Magdalene is mentioned in all four Gospels by name as being one of the folks to find an empty tomb. She is mentioned by name in the New Testament 12 times more than many of the apostles. She was a known traveler with the disciples and other followers of Christ during his earthly ministry. I'll never forget a few years ago, I had the opportunity to go with someone to a Celebrate Recovery meeting at Biltmore Church in Arden. When we went to this meeting, we walked into the back of the room and took our seat. The place was absolutely packed. And as we were in this worship service, I began to feel the power of the Holy Spirit in that room as I'd never felt it before. I was looking around a room packed with probably 300 to 400 addicts, 300 to 400 people who had literally lived hell in their lives. And these 300 to 400 people that literally had lived hell in their lives and found victory in Jesus Christ truly knew what they were worshiping. And so when we think about the resurrection of Jesus Christ and we think about Mary Magdalene, I told you to remember that name. I hope that when we're finished on this Easter Sunday today, that you never forget this lady. And when we think about Mary Magdalene, and we think about how often she's mentioned in the New Testament, let me remind you that when Jesus repeats himself and God sees fit to say someone's name over and over again, it would do you and I a good justice to listen. There's a reason that at every account she is mentioned. Based on the evidence found in the Gospels, I believe the steadfast faith and belief Mary Magdalene had in Christ was because of what Christ had done for her. Truly, she knew the life. Her life had changed since Jesus had came into her life. Mark and Luke, in their account of his life, Jesus' life, both tell us that Jesus had cast out demons from Mary's life. I put a little quote on Facebook last night, and I want to repeat this again concerning Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene didn't follow Jesus for popularity. She followed Jesus because he healed her soul and gave her a purpose. What we see in Luke chapter 24 is that the apostles, when they first get the word that Jesus had resurrected, we have even underlined idle tales, they believe it to be nonsense. The apostles and many others just couldn't believe it. No way this had happened. Now, Jesus had told them that he would rise again. The angels even reminded Mary Magdalene and the other women. They say the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. So what I want to do this morning is offer everyone an invitation to experience the empty tomb. Because I don't want to act like a fool this morning, because I'm afraid that many people listening, you may be tuning in out of curiosity. You may be tuning in saying, well, let's just see what this Easter thing is all about. Let me say, I want to invite you to experience Jesus Christ and his resurrection for yourself. What we see is that Luke describes that Peter ran to the tomb. What he found was grave clothes and no Jesus. Let me remind you that the living does not need grave clothes. I can tell you that two disciples experienced time with Christ after the resurrection. I can tell you that Jesus allowed the disciples and a doubting Thomas to see his hands and feet where the nails pierced them. I can tell you Jesus did many miraculous things after the resurrection in front of his disciples. I can tell you Jesus appeared to 500 people at once after his resurrection. But why? What is it that makes his resurrection so important? Why does it matter so much? Again, I'm going to give you an invitation to find out. You will find out that his resurrection is victory. Every year they crown a World Series champion and they give the winning team the Commissioner's Trophy. In the NBA, the champion is awarded the Larry O'Brien Championship Trophy. The NFL at the Super Bowl awards the victor the Vince Lombardi Trophy. See, here's the thing. Each year, a new champion is awarded. Each year gives someone an opportunity to be crowned the champion. It is great today on this Easter Sunday for me to inform you that the champion of love, Jesus Christ, he's the one that defeated death forever. His resurrection from death after laying his life down for humanity can never be matched. His resurrection sealed forever that he was the perfect sacrifice, a sacrifice that lasts forever. If he would have stayed dead, another atonement would be needed. But by rising in victory, It revealed the eternal seal of forever we now have by trusting in Christ for eternal salvation. The book of Romans chapter 6 verse 10 says, for the death that he died to sin once for all. But the life that he lives to God. I want us to think, just as we're about to wrap up, let's think about Mary Magdalene just for a few minutes. I said I wanted to offer an invitation to experience the resurrection. Maybe you're out there today and you're listening and your life is an absolute mess. I don't know everybody in your life story and what you've been through or what you're going through, but I want to say that I want to offer you to accept Christ as your personal Savior, because in Him is where you're going to find complete joy. In Jesus Christ is where you're going to find where your relationships, every one of them, hinge. In order for your relationships in life to be right, you've got to be right with Jesus Christ. See, Mary Magdalene was one who had experienced the life-changing touch of Jesus Christ. She was there with Him as He performed many miracles. We're even told in the gospel accounts that she watched the crucifixion. And then we're told by all four of the writers, by name, she's mentioned as finding an empty tomb. Let me say this, that church listening, if you've accepted Christ as your Savior and the power of the resurrection lives in you, and today you've experienced that victory, the Bible says that you are the salt of the earth. And so I want to ask you a question. Are you living a life that is salt, that preserves? Or are you living a life that is like sugar and is sweet for a while and falls away? So you're in two boats this morning. You've either accepted this by faith and you know the power of the resurrection in your life, or you've never accepted it. Think about Mary Magdalene and the change that happened in her life and how God uses her for us today. Think about it this way. As I mentioned earlier, when I went and worshiped with a room full of folks who had been to hell and back and knew what Jesus had done in their life, they worshiped a risen Savior. Lee Strobel said this in his book, Case for Christ, faith is only as good as the one in whom it's invested. I want to ask everybody a question today. What are you putting your faith and trust in? Maybe you're out there in the resurrection story and Jesus arising from the dead has been nonsense to you, but your life's in a tailspin. I want to offer you an invitation to experience victory for yourself. I want to encourage you to give Jesus a chance to be Lord of your life and to bring peace and joy to you on this Easter. And then I want to remind you of something right before we sing another song. When Jesus ran into His disciples after the resurrection, He says two words in the KJV. It's interpreted, Jesus said, all hail. Those two words mean rejoice. There's one thing that we need to do. You've experienced victory and you know Him as Lord and Savior on this Easter. Do as Jesus commanded His disciples and rejoice. You don't have to be in this building here with us today to do that. You can be right there in your living room. Rejoice in the resurrection, because He didn't stay dead. He arose victorious. So you may be thinking nonsense. I'm saying give Him a try. If you know Him, rejoice. Here's what we're going to do. Once everybody just at home, those scattered around here that's came to sing, let's just bow our heads, close our eyes. If you're out there today
and you need to ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, I'm going to lead you in a prayer, and I want you to pray this from your heart to God's heart and ask him to come and to redeem and to save you from your sin and experience the power of the resurrection and the victory that comes. If you've never done that, say this prayer. Dear Jesus, I know that I am a sinner. I believe now that you died on the cross and that you resurrected. I believe, as we've read this morning, he has risen to be that perfect sacrifice for me. Thank you, Jesus, for saving me from my sins. In Jesus' name, amen. Listen, if you, for the first time today, ask Jesus to come into your life and accept him as your Savior, just shoot us a message through Facebook. I would love to get in touch with you and share with you the next steps in your Christian journey. Church, as Brian comes, he's going to sing Amazing Grace, and that will end our time together this morning. Happy Easter. It's not nonsense. He's alive. Live victorious in Jesus.
We've no less to when we first begun.
Lead us in a close prayer. Again, I hope you have a great day. Happy Easter. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this time together this morning. We thank you for what the power of the resurrection is to those who have believed. I pray for the many that are watching. I pray that we all will live victorious and realize that you are alive today. You are not dead. You are not in a grave. You're not in a tomb. You have ascended up into the heavens and took your rightful place, seated beside your Father. And one day you are going to come and rescue the church, and we're going to live with you forever. We're thankful for the eternal plan that you have for the church. I thank you for these singers. I thank you for the Holy Spirit that we have felt. Be with everyone in their homes today. Help us to know what a privilege and what a blessing it is to know our God is not dead. So we ask this prayer in the powerful name of the one who is alive. His name is Jesus. Amen.